Hello and welcome. In this session, we are going to discuss a new topic called Diophantine equations. The name Diophantine came from the Greek mathematician Diophantus. These are equations with integral coefficients and we require integer solutions for these equations. Though we are discussing initially general type of Diophantine equations, we will be focusing on linear Diophantine equations. We are going to discuss Diophantine equations now. A very simple Diophantine equation is an equation in one variable with integer coefficients, right? Something like this: ax is equal to b, where a, b, they are integers. For example, consider 5x is equal to 20, and we know that there is a solution x is equal to 4. Therefore, this is a Diophantine equation with solution x equal to 4. Now, if we consider another Diophantine equation, 5x is equal to 24, the only one solution for this equation is 24 by 5, and this is not an integer, and there is no other solution for this 5x is equal to 24. Therefore, this Diophantine equation has no solution. Another class of interesting Diophantine equations is equation of the form x square plus y square, two variable equal to, now in fact three variable, x square plus y square equal to z square. We know that if we consider x, y, z are as the sides of right triangles, then this is actually the Pythagoras theorem, which states that the square of the length of the largest side is equal to sum of the squares of lengths of the other two sides. And we know that there are many solutions for this Diophantine equation in integers. For example, we have 3, 4, 5 is the solution for this equation. Also, obviously, 0, 0, 0 is another solution for this Diophantine equation. Now, one interesting historical fact is that if we consider the equation x raised to n plus y raised to n plus, or otherwise we will not take n, x raised to 3 x cube plus y cube equal to z cube, and if you require integer solutions for this equation, it is a known fact that 0, 0, 0 is the only solution for this Diophantine equation, and this is nothing but Fermat's last theorem. Fermat's last theorem says that the equation, Diophantine equation, x raised to n plus y raised to n equal to z raised to n, when n greater than or equal to 3, it has only trivial solution. Therefore, this is another Diophantine equation. Now, when we have the variables in the Diophantine equation as power equal to 1 and there are no mixed terms appearing like x into y, y into z, etc., then we say that such a Diophantine equation is a linear Diophantine equation. So, linear Diophantine equation. This is an equation of the form a x1 raised to some m1, sorry, there is no m1, a x1 plus, or a1 x1 plus a2 x2 plus etc. ak xk equal to b. Such an equation in variables x1, x2, etc., xk with integer coefficients a1, a2, etc., ak, and b also an integer, is known as a linear Diophantine equation. Now, we are going to consider that, of course, the simplest example is going to be of the form ax equal to b. The next equation, probably the simpler part, is going to be of the form ax plus by is equal to c, where a, b, c are all integers. A, b, c are all integers. For the simpler equation ax equal to b, we know that this is very easy to solve because there is only one variable, and if at all there is a solution, we know that there is only one solution for ax equal to b, because if b is equal to 0 and a not equal to 0, then x is going to be definitely 0. But if b is equal to 0 and a is equal to 0, of course, there are infinitely many solutions. Ax equal to b will be having infinitely many solutions. Now, what about ax plus by is equal to c? We know that ax plus by is equal to c actually represents a line. For example, consider 2x plus 3y equal to 0. So, can we get at least one solution for this definite equation? 2x plus 3y is equal to 0. We can see that if you multiply 2 with 3 and 3 with minus 2. So, 3 minus 2 is of course a solution. That means that the line 2x plus 3y passes through 3 minus 2. And of course, we can have another solution, which is minus 3, 2. This is also another solution. So, if we try to draw the graph of this 2x plus 3y is equal to 0, which is a straight line. If you try to draw this, this intersects at this line intersects at 3 minus 2. So if you mark 1 here, 2 here, 3 here, and minus 1 here, minus 2 here. So 1, 2, 3, minus 1, minus 2, somewhere here minus 3. So 2x plus 3y, we have seen that passes through 3 minus 2. So 1, 2, 3. So 3 minus 2 means you have to take on the y-axis minus 2, which is here. So this is one point, and the other point is minus 3, 2. So we need to extend this line. We are extending. So minus 3, this is minus 3, and 2. 2 is, so 2 is here. So if we join these two lines, we get line like this. But of course, there is something wrong in what we have drawn, because this should actually pass through the origin, because we know that 0, 0 is obviously a solution. So we will just remove this point, and somewhere here it should appear. This is a problem with the scale that we have chosen. So this should pass through this. So this is the line 2x plus, this is the line 2x plus 3y equal to 0. This line passes through the integer points 3 minus 2 and minus 3, 2. And if the points on the plane with integer coefficients or integer coordinates, these points are known as lattice points. So lattice points are points with integer coordinates. So this line passes through the lattice points 3 minus 2. Of course, 0, 0 is another point. It passes through 0, 0 also. It passes through minus 3, 2. And it is possible that there exist many more other lattice points lying on this line. And all these lattice points lying on this line will be solutions for 2x plus 3y is equal to 0. Therefore, solutions exist for 2x plus 3y is equal to 0. And there are many solutions. We have already seen 3, and we don't know whether there are more solutions, but we can probably guess that there are many more solutions, because if you multiply x with if you multiply 2 with a multiple of 3 and 3 with a multiple of 2, probably we can just manage in such a way that the sum will become equal to 0. This is a Diophantine, linear Diophantine equation. Now we are going to discuss, if given a linear Diophantine equation in two variables, when can we find a solution for such a linear Diophantine equation? And not only that, if at all we can find solutions, how many solutions will there exist, and how to find all these solutions? Therefore, the questions are the following. Question number one. So we are considering linear Diophantine equations of the form ax plus by equal to c and of course A, B, C are all integers. Question number one. When is this solvable? That is, when can we find xy in z2 such that ax plus by is equal to c is satisfied? This is the first question. Next is, if this is solvable, how many solutions may exist? That is question number 2 and 3. How to find all such solutions? So these are the three questions that we are going to ask and probably try to find answers. So the questions are, when is this linear definite equation ax plus by is equal to c is going to be solvable? If this is solvable, how many solutions there may exist, and how to find all such solutions? These are the questions that we are going to ask. If you recall the one of the previous sessions, we have already seen that ax plus by is equal to d, that is the Bessel's identity, and we have seen that the set of all numbers ax plus by, set of all numbers of the form ax plus by is, they are all multiples of d. So this is a known fact for us. The set ax plus by, where x and y are integers, this is equal to nothing but d is a, where d equal to GCD of a, b. Therefore, if this is equal to d z, that means that any element in ax plus by, the set of all ax plus by, must be a multiple of d. And if it is not a multiple of d, it cannot be in ax plus by. Therefore, the first question we are going to partially answer, when is this solvable? So we can see that ax plus by is always a multiple of d, and therefore if this has to be solvable, then c must be a multiple of d. And not only that, if c is a multiple of d, using Bessel's identity, we can find a solution for this expression. So this is what we are going to prove first. Show that ax plus by is equal to c is solvable for xy in z2 if and only if d divides c, where d equal to GCD of a. Okay, the solution for this problem is going to be quite straightforward, given that we understood the idea that GCD is the smallest element in ax plus the set of ax plus by, smallest positive element in set of ax plus by, and the set ax plus by is generated by d. Okay, now suppose that ax plus by is solved. Suppose ax plus by equal to c is solved. Therefore, there exists x naught, y naught in z2. This is solvable means we can find some value for x, some value for y, so that substituting that value in ax and ax plus by, that will give z. So that ax naught plus by naught equal to c. Now we have to show that d divides c. Now d divides a implies d divides ax naught, d divides b, because d is a GCD, implies d divides b y naught, but then d divides the sum. Therefore, d divides ax naught plus b y naught, but that is nothing but c. Therefore, d divides c. So, if ax plus by is solvable, then definitely d, the GCD, divides c. Now, on the other hand, suppose that d divides c, and we will show that ax plus by is equal to c has a solution xy in z. Conversely, suppose d divides c, we have to show that ax plus by is equal to c is solvable. What is meant by saying that ax plus by is equal to c is solvable? We have to find values for x and y integers such that if we put those values into ax plus by, then it will become equal to c. Now we are going to use Bezos identity there exist x naught and y naught in z such that d equal to ax naught plus b y naught. This is x naught and y naught is given by x naught y naught are given by Bezos identity. Now it's given that d divides c. D divides c implies there exist e integer such that c is equal to d into e. Therefore, if we multiply e on both sides of this equation, therefore de equal to a e x naught plus b e y naught. But this is nothing but this is am plus bn, and de is nothing but it's equal to c. So we found m and n such that c is equal to am plus bn, and therefore ax plus by is solved. Therefore ax plus by is equal to c is solvable, and one solution is this m. Yeah. So what we proved is, if c is a multiple of d, the GCD, then ax plus by is equal to c is solvable. But remember that to find the solution, we need to write d as a linear combination of a and b. And from that linear combination, that x naught and y naught multiplied with e, where c is equal to d, that gives the solution for ax plus by is equal to c. Therefore, the solution depends on if we are able to find, of course we will be able to find, because this certainly says that there exists x naught and y naught. So for finding the solution, we need to find x naught and y naught appearing in the Bezos identity. Note that finding solution for the linear differential equation ax plus by is equal to c depends on finding the Bezos identity coefficients x naught and y naught in d equal to ax plus by. But we have seen previously that if we use Euclidean algorithm and work backward to find the coefficients, that is going to be somewhat a difficult task if there are too many steps involved in the Euclidean algorithm. So we are trying to see an easy to use method for finding the Bezos identity coefficients, and we will do it using the next problem. We will try to explain how to use that technique. So we are starting with a very simple example. Find the GCD of 15 and 9. This is quite a simple example. So if we use the Euclidean algorithm, using Euclidean algorithm, we write 15 is equal to 9 into 1 plus 6, 9 is equal to 6 into 1 plus 3, 6 is equal to 3 into 2 plus 0, and so the GCD is equal to 3, the last non-zero coefficient. Now the algorithm is something like this, the technique is something like this. So remember that we have to express 3 as a linear combination of 15 and 9. That is what precisely we want. We want to express, we want 3 to be written as x into, suppose we take the least one first, and y into 15, and we have to find this x and y. So for that, can we write 15 in terms of 15 and 9? So one obvious way is to write 15 equal to 9 into 0 plus 15 into 1. This is our x, this is our y. Now we can write 9 also in the same way. This is 9 into 1 plus 15 into 0. Now we have subtract, we know that we can subtract from 15 only 1 times 9. So that is equivalent to subtracting, if you are multiplying this row with 1, suppose that we are multiplying this line, this equation with 1, therefore we are getting 1 into 9 equal to 1 into or 9 into 1 itself into some 1 extra, 15 into 0 into 1. Therefore if we subtract this first equation, this equation and second equation from the first one, we will be getting 15 minus 9, that is nothing but equal to 6. And now here we have 9 into 0, here we have 9 into 1. If we subtract 9 into 0 minus 1, that is 9 into minus 1 plus 15 into 1 and 15 into 0 into 1, that is 15 into 0. So 15 into 1 minus 0, that is going to be 15 into 1 itself. So these are the two numbers that we are getting here. In the, remember that here still we have 6 is equal to a linear combination of 9 and 15, 9 equal to a linear combination of 9 and 15. Now we are going to write down this 9 below. Once again, 9 equal to 9 into 1 plus 15 into 0. And 6, how many 6's can be subtracted from 9? So this is 1 into 6 is equal to 9 into minus 1 into 1 plus 15 into 0 into 1. So if we subtract these two equations, we get 9 into 1 minus 6, that is equal to 3 equal to 9 into 1 9 minus minus 1, therefore this is equal to 9 into 2 plus 15 into 0, 15 into 0, therefore this is going to be equal to 15 into here we have 6 into 15 into 1 we had, so we need to keep this 1 here, therefore 15 into 0, 15 into 1, so 0 minus 1, therefore this is going to be equal to minus 1, so we get 3 equal to 9 into 2 plus 15 into minus, is this correct? This is 9 into 12, 9 into 2, 18 minus 15, that's correct. Okay, now we are proceeding like that. So the next step would be, what would be the next step? We have to subtract from 6 this. Remember, just observe that 3 is still a combination of 9 and 15. 6 is a combination of 9 and 15. So we have, so how many times 3 can be subtracted from 6? So we are again writing that 6 is equal to, we are just taking 9 into minus 1, 15 into 1. 9 into minus 1 plus 15 into 1, and 3 we can multiply 2 times, 2 into 3 equal to, so we have to multiply 2 times on the right side, 2 on the right side, so 9 into 4, 9 into 4 plus 15 into minus 1, minus 1 into 2, so 15 into minus 2. So if we subtract, we get 0 equal to 9 into minus 5 plus 15 into 3. Is this correct? 15 into 3, 45, 9 into 1. So we got finally the remainder to be equal to 0. And what is the last notice of the remainder? If you observe here we have got 3 equal to 9 into 2 plus 15 into minus 1. See, in fact, we have got the GCD as a linear combination of the two numbers here itself. Observe the steps we followed. We will do one more problem to clarify the concepts. What we have done is we wrote the number, the first number, as a linear combination of the given two numbers, second number also as a linear combination of the given two numbers. From the larger number, we subtracted the row containing the least number, as many multiples as possible, and we kept on doing like that. This is basically the Euclidean algorithm itself, but we used a row-like structure. We kept on subtracting. Now, instead of writing down all these expressions, we are going to just write down the coefficients. See that here, we perform the multiplication on this 1. Here, we perform the multiplication on 0. 15 is just staying here. So we are going to perform these operations on the coefficients in the next problem. To get some space, we will probably move to... Okay, we are writing the next question. Find B source identity coefficient for 1876 and 365, two numbers chosen. So we have to find the B source identity coefficient, that is, if D equal to GCD of 1876 and 365, find X naught, Y naught in Z such that B equal to 1876 X naught plus 365 Y naught. So exactly the same procedure as in the previous problem we are going to follow, but the only difference is that we are going to focus only on the coefficients. So we know that the larger number 1876 is equal to 365 into 0 plus 1876 into 1, and 365 is nothing but this is 365 into 1 plus 1876 into 0. So instead of writing down all these things, we are just going to focus on the coefficients, and we write down the numbers here, 1876, 365. See, this coefficient, suppose we call the coefficient of 365 as x and 1876 as y. So we have x here, y here. So x is nothing but in the first expression, this is 0, this is 1, here it is 1, here it is 0. Now, how many times we can subtract 365 from 1876? So we are again writing it, 1876 minus 365. We can subtract 5 times and the remainder is going to be equal to 50. 1876 is equal to 365 into 5 plus 51. Therefore, we can subtract 5 times. So 1876 0 1 365, this is 5 into 3, or 365 into 5, and if you multiply with 5, the coefficient 1 here, so here we get this into 5, this also into 5, so 5 into 1, 5 into 0, and now we subtract and we get, here we get 51, and here we get minus 5, here we get 1. Now, how many times this 51 can be subtracted from 365? 51, 365 is equal to 51 into 7 plus 8. So we are going to subtract from 365 51 times 7, and therefore 365 equal to 365, I am writing here, and here I have the coefficients are 1 and 0, these are my x and y, and 51 into 7, therefore minus 5 into 7 and 1 into 7. So if we subtract, we get this equal to 8, and this is minus, this is 36 and this is minus 7. We are continuing this process. Now we have to take care of 51, and 51 is equal to 8 into 6 plus 8 into 6 plus 3, and therefore we can subtract from 51, 8 times this row, 6 times this row we can subtract. So 51, what is that row? Oh, 51, 51 has row minus 5, 1, and from that 8 into 6 we are subtracting, 8 is nothing but 36 minus 7, so into 6, therefore 36 into 6 and minus 7 into 6. On subtracting, we get this equal to 3 equal to, so if we subtract, we get minus 221. We just verify yourself, minus 221, and this is minus, this is 43. So we get 3 equal to minus 221. So the what we are doing is, we are writing, we have 3 equal to minus 221 into 365 plus 43 into 1876. This is what we are getting here. So if we continue this process, what is the next step that we have to take? We have to take 8 and we have to subtract 3 from that. So we write 8 equal to how many times 3 can be subtracted? 3 into 2 plus 2. So from 8 you have to subtract 3, 2 times that row. So what is the row of 8? Row of 8 is 8, 36 minus 7. So 8, 36, this is x, this is y, minus 7, and 3 into 2, and what is the row of 3? Minus 221, 43. So minus 221 into 2, 43 into 2. So if we subtract these two, we get here 8 into this is 2, and here we get 478 minus 73. Verify once again yourself. Now what is the next? What is next? Now we have 3 here, the row of 3 here. How many times 2 can be subtracted? We know that 3 is equal to 2 into 1 plus 1. Therefore we can subtract only 1 times this row from the row of 3. What is the row of 3? The row of 3 is 3 minus 221, 43. 3 minus 221, 43. From that subtract 2478 minus 73, and if we subtract, we get this is going to be equal to 1, and this is going to be equal to 699136. Once again verify yours, and see that this is the least remainder possible, because we know that 1 is the least remainder possible other than 0. So next is definitely going to be, the remainder is going to be 0, therefore this is the GCD. So 1 is the GCD, because anything else less than 1 is going to be 0, but we want the last non-zero remainder, therefore GCD of 1876 and 365 is 1, and 1 equal to 699 into 365 plus 136 into 1876. So we have found the business identity coefficients in this. Next one is a simple question. So question is this: is 2x plus 6y equal to 5 solved? You can easily see that the GCD of 2 and 6 is equal to 2, and 2 does not divide the C equal to 5, therefore equation is not solvable for integer x and y. Now another question is 2x plus 7y equal to 24 solvable. This is actually very easy to answer because we know that 2 is a prime and 7 is also a prime. Therefore, they are distinct primes. Therefore, the GCD is equal to 2, 7, GCD is 1. And 1 divides any 6. Therefore, 1 divides 24 also. Therefore, this has a solution. Therefore, it is solved. Therefore, the observation here is that if AX plus BY, in AX plus BY, if A and B are relatively prime, then the GCD is 1 and therefore it divides the right side always. Therefore, there is always a solution. So, the observation is this: if in AX plus BY is equal to C, GCD of AB equal to 1, then the linear Diophantine equation is always solvable. That means for any value of C. So this is always solvable for any value of C if the numbers A and B are relatively prime. Now with this we have completed one part of the question that we initially asked. What was that question? We initially asked that the linear Diophantine equation, when is this going to be solvable? And we have answered that this is solvable if and only if the GCD of A and B divide C. Now, how many solutions there exist and how to find out solutions, we will discuss in the next session. We are stopping here. Thank you.